Why would evolution have made a Triceratops and a Sinoceratops?
They're a separate type of Ceratopsian. Yeah. Triceratops is a Chasmosaurini Ceratopsian, which are a group of Ceratopsians with large brow horns, longer neck frills, and shorter nose horns. The Sinoceratops is a Centrosaurini, which don't have brow horns at all. Some have little ones, but they have much shorter frills and larger nose horns. And they lived on different continents. Like, Triceratops lived in North America, Sinoceratops lived in China. What's interesting is that Sinoceratops was the first large Ceratopsian to be discovered in China, while all of its other large relatives were living in North America.
Oh.
It shows you that Ceratopsians were also getting big in China too during the late Cretaceous period.
Wow. Giganotosaurus, the new apex predator that they introduce in the movie. Tell me all about this new dinosaur.
It is true, the Giganotosaurus is a bigger theropod than Tyrannosaurus Rex. Though, as I've stated, some T-Rex specimens are about the same length, but Giganotosaurus is bigger than most specimens and scientists have discovered. It's about 40 feet long, 45 feet long, and it belongs to a group called Carcharodontosaurus. So as I said, Allosaurus is my favorite non-bird dinosaur. The Carcharodontosaurus are a subgroup of the Allosaur family tree that diversified after the Jurassic period. In the Cretaceous, the Carcharodontosaurus were the dominant predators around the world in the northern and the southern hemisphere. Giganotosaurus lived in the southern hemisphere in Argentina, South America, so that's where it reigned supreme, along with some other Carcharodontosaurs that also lived in Argentina, like Mapusaurus, Eocarcharia, and Tyrannotitan. So Giganotosaurus lived with some of its other relatives.
That thing that's on your shirt.
Oh, dimetrodon. These are these really cool sail-backed animals that they're not even ceropsids. They're more closely related to mammals than they are to like other dinosaurs.
Yeah.
They even lived before the dinosaurs too, the Paleozoic, and all kind of went all extinct at the end, Permian extinction. They had these huge sails on their back and those really big jaws. And if you look at their legs, one of the most distinguished things about what separates them from the dinosaurs is their legs are splayed out to the side rather than under them.
And what's the sail all about?
Could be that it would be good for temperature regulation. I know that's proposed a lot. But more likely, I think it'd be more just display. You know, you look at these things and it's the bigger the sail, you're going to scare off other animals, but more likely also other dimetrodons that are going after your mates and everything.
No, you can't take DNA out of a mosquito trapped in amber because DNA decays too quickly when an animal dies. There's no way I'm going to extract DNA from a 145 million year old brachiosaurus.
So as far as you know, there is no DNA source that we could ever...
No, there's
not
no,
a tooth or a bone or...
Yeah, we do have soft tissues of other stuff like blood cells and medullary tissue, which is the stuff to create eggshell, but
Does DNA have DNA in it? No.
None of those have DNA in it.
I mean, there's even some talk now of trying to recreate like the woolly mammoth, which the last woolly mammoth went extinct 5,000 years ago.
Yeah. That thing might be coming back.
Well, there's a park up in the Yukon called Beringia Park where they are trying to recreate the mammoth. They want to introduce muskox and like almost make like an ice age.
I think I'd rather move on to my favorite pterosaur, the quetzalcoatlus. But yeah, the quetzalcoatlus is my favorite. I could like other Azedaricid pterosaurs, but the quetzalcoatlus is one of the most well-known pterosaurs.
Yeah.
So yeah, imagine my pinky finger is a bit long and the wing is attached to the tip that extends all the way to my ankle, and then I have that membranous wing for me to soar over long distances. Though there has been some question, can a large pterosaur like Quetzalcoatlus even take to the sky? But whenever it needs to, it probably would have maybe just hunched back a little bit and then just give it a little thrust and then pull its wings out and give it a little bit of flap so it can get higher and higher and higher up into the sky, and then pretty much would just glide rather than flap them. We have proposed that maybe they did headbutting contests like bighorn sheep, but a lot of scientists have been arguing with this topic. They don't think that their heads and their necks were reinforced to withstand the pressure for butting heads, so sometimes some scientists speculate that maybe they just headbutted their flanks, like their sides. So they would just headbutt their sides and stuff. But some scientists have done finite element analysis, which is the study of stresses, like when engineers are building bridges to understand the stress points.
Oh, interesting. They can maybe determine how they were,
what was going on.
So they did that.
Because evolution would have reinforced whatever was working.
And they found out that maybe their heads and necks were strong enough to withstand all that pressure when they're butting heads. So this is still a debatable issue, but some scientists do agree with the head butting strategy.
You look at modern animals like bighorn sheep, they actually have a little bit of more reinforcement and buttressing in the lower neck area to withstand that impact when they hit each other.
Wow.
Yeah. Stegosaurus lived so far in time away from Tyrannosaurus.
Mm-hmm.
I think separated by 75 million years.
Yeah.
We're separated 66 million years from T-Rex.
So
we lived closer to T-Rex than T-Rex did to Stegosaurus.
No way.
Dinosaurs dominated the Earth for such a long time. It's mind-boggling.